One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
As a filmmaker, you kind of seem to be in the spirit of...
I'm laying it on the line a little bit, laying it on the open.
Laying it on the open?
Yeah, laying it open, you know.
Well, you're it's almost like a collage more than a film.
People have referred to it as a tone poem, which is not my favorite term, but
I will not use it then.
Okay, thank you. fragments is how I kind of refer to it, and that speaks to the collaginess of it. But the fragments feel like they all could be in line somewhere. You know, I feel like they're, to me, while there isn't a three-act structure, there's definitely a beginning, a middle, and an end. There seems to be a real trajectory. Mm-hmm. So those fragments are like icicles kind of coming down. You know, they're all connected, but they're all separate.
So did this develop over time as a form, or?
Well, that's how we approached it. I mean, the thing about this kind of film is I'm not interested in an establishing shot, and then guy walks into a room, guy has a scene, guy leaves the room, next establishing shot. I'd rather like find out one thing about that, those possibilities, just one thing, and mm-hmm. use that something that advances the story, maybe in a minimal way, or maybe in a super subtle way, or maybe in a way that just feels right. But it doesn't have to be as sensical, you know? And I feel like if you build on that, you keep building on that, and it takes you in different directions. And that can be a really positive experience if you're, you know, flexible.
So, again, where did that come from? From an art experience? Was that another filmmaker that was influencing that idea? Or?
Well, I think it comes from the boundaries in a way. Like, if you have, my first film, I had very little money, called Pavilion. I had very little money, and I wanted to make a film about youth. So I found teenagers, you know, and I got into this whole non-actor, like working with non-actors and feeling like there was a lot great performances. Better performances from the non-actors than mm-hmm. the actors a lot of the time. And at the same time, you don't have a lot of money. You don't want to create a movie that, I'm not going to make a $40,000 movie and try and make it look or feel or act like a $4 million movie. Right. So you have to build a world according to your resources. And that felt like, to me, what felt natural was this world of in between documentary and fiction. Something that's storytelling, but not conform to one form of storytelling. And I got really into that. And
so where are you when you're in it? I mean, is there a conventional script? Is there any script?
There's no script. It starts with, Memphis started with a 40-page document. It's like part short story, part treatment. And it shows the whole thing, the descent and, mm-hmm. and kind of like vanishing into the woods. And it has a lot of the same characters, but it's really was there just to get people interested. DP, producer, Venice Biennale, who paid for it, Willis. But then when we were on set, we really put it away and we would just take the basic blocks out of that and then mm-hmm. build around it. So we knew we had a church scene and we knew we had a mansion scene. We knew we had these places where he went. And then we would just build mood and different kinds of scenes as we went.
So is there a call sheet?
Yeah. It was a great production. It was a total, like, there's a catering table, there's, you know, like, there's an art department, there's a grip department. I mean, very small, but no, it was run completely professionally, but it was also run in a way like almost a accented documentary crew, in a way.
So in your day I guess, I don't know if you had 2 days or whether it just is shot to look like 2 days, feel like 2 days, but in the church.
Uh-huh, two different days.
Are you going in and saying, okay, I'm trying to capture this mood, I'm trying to mm-hmm. capture this beat within yeah. everything else that happens, do what you would do in a church
yes,
day?
Yes.
What is, okay.
And I said one thing. We have one character, he's a fictional character, and he's come to Memphis, and he's looking, and he's lost. He's lost, and he's coming to your church. That's it. That's the only thing. You're going to invite him up, you're going to ask him to sing. And the only thing I told to Willis was, you cannot sing. So the rest of the church we had been to that church 5 times before rolling any camera. Uh-huh. I had spoken at the church twice. Like, they knew exactly what we were going for, and we shot it very documentary style. It was just a cameraman, a sound guy, the crew was outside. We had Willis come in, do his thing, Willis come out. But while it was all there, it was very, very real. They weren't faking how they feel about him. They see him as this soul supposed to sing. He doesn't sing. They want to give him a hug. It's all It's all real. And if I had tried to say, okay, we're going to come back here on Tuesday, we're going to create a Sunday service, I don't have the resources and I don't have the skills as a director to do that. Mm-hmm. What we do have is we have this thing happening in front of us. How do we capture that with respect, but also lean it on our story a little bit?
So did somebody make a change in the music?
What do you mean?
Was there when the guy starts complaining about somebody had made a change and he didn't know what the change was?
Oh, in that scene, in that sequence, that's all real. That's all real.
So did you set that up to make that somebody would do something that would upset him?
No, or? It could have gone whatever way it went. Like, Willis is a very temperamental artist, and those other guys are very temperamental, old school artists. Mm-hmm. They're used to doing it a certain way. So we knew that the whole point was get Willis in a room and say, you're recording an album, you're recording a record, and hire the musicians. That's Al Green's band. Like, hire the real deal, put you in there. If it's a disaster, great. If it's great, wow, what promise. You know, So it went the way it went, which was Willis trying to do his amorphous thing over this blues record, and these guys saying, "What change was that y'all right. played?" You know.
So where are you? How many days of production?
21 days. 21 shoot days. The last 3 days we were shooting only a few hours a day, though. It was very relaxed by the end.
So when you're at day 10. Do you know where you're at? Do you care whether you know where you're at?
Or I absolutely know where I'm at, and my producer knows where we're at. There's a lot of questions. There's a million questions, and there's a million decisions to make, and there's a million choices. But there's lots of scenes that are on the cutting room floor. There's lots of moments that absolutely don't work. However, the essence of what was working was always very much what you see in the film. It's very much the backbone of the film. A lot of things we tried didn't work, but that's any movie. But we always kind of knew where we were in the story, where Willis was in the story, and where we wanted it to go. But we were open to like where it could go.
Did you shoot in any progression, or was it just?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, so it was in order.
It's totally in order. Willis is not an actor. He had to start one way and end up another way. It's all whatever you call it, linear.
Well, it's reminiscent in some ways of Boyhood. Ironically, this year, just in that. It's different in many ways also, sure. But it's the idea of Rick, you know, being able to stop each year, you know, and really considering where they were and what was coming next and what they wanted to say in the next year scene and everything else or the sequence. It sounds almost like you're taking that breath as you go along through each day and, you know.
It's that's a great observation. What I loved about Boyhood is all of a sudden you just one cut and another cut, you're just moved, you're a year ahead. That there wasn't a black space between it, or there wasn't a title card or anything. That all of a sudden you were just, it was just happening. Mm-hmm. And you had to go with it. And it's hard at first. And I really love that about Boyhood, because they made a really, really natural movie about time. And I was trying to make a kind of metaphysical movie about time a little bit. I wanted someone mm-hmm. to progress, but into almost dissolve. And you had to do that. We had to make it feel like it was really happening. Willis had to do it himself. We had to be open to we had to just be open to, if he disappeared one day, then the movie had to be about those kids, and we would just go with them, and it would be about absence. Like, we just had to be ready to go with how life kind of led us.
So you were willing.
Willing.
You were a willing director.
I'm a willing director, and also you have a certain amount of money. You're funded by an art institute who knows you're out to make an art film.
And how did that happen, by the way?
What is the Venice Biennale put out a call to finance 3 films. There were 500 submissions. You go the round of 15. It's like Top Chef. You know, the round of 15 goes to Venice to pitch. Mm-hmm. And then you pitch to the head of the Biennale and head of the Venice Film Festival, and then we were one of the 3 films. Then they send you out with 150,000 euros, which is 200 grand, and you have to get it done for the Venice Film Festival. So you have 8 months.
So what is your pitch? What was your pitch?
My pitch was talking about, my pitch was about a person who's touched by God who cannot perform what people want him to perform. But the godliness was very, I think the Italians really dug, because, you know, we're in this building that's like the art war capital of like antiquity, and, you know, God and art just like mixed well for me there. John went in, said how we were gonna do it, and then we showed a video clip of Willis. Mm-hmm. Willis is just if you're not with me and you're not with John, you'll get with Willis, because he's so magnetic and his voice is just so rich.
And for people watching, explain who John is.
John is John Baker, my producer, who also produced a movie called Dragon Slayer, which is a doc that won South by Southwest. And Willis is Willis Earl Beale, who is the lead of the movie.
I thought maybe it was the old Dragon Slayer with the giant dragon and...
No, it's the
voiced
good...
Voiced by Sean Connery.
No, it's the good Dragon Slayer.
Or no, Dragon Slayer was the other one, the Disney one, wasn't it?
I don't know.
There was a good version. I think Dragon Slayer was actually the good dragon movie.
Oh.
A long time.
I remember it.
Back in the land before CG.
I think John wouldn't mind having a little bit of that cash in a movie coming up, but let's see.
So the Biennale is behind you.
Biennale is behind you, and you have a certain amount of money, you can be a willing director. Like, you, if you're not a willing director and you become more of a fascist, first of all, people have a bad experience, and that shows in your movie. Mm-hmm. So if you show people that you're open to ideas and you're open to the story that could go anywhere, like, they go on a trip. It was a real journey. So people get on that journey, and all of a sudden it becomes their movie too. The production designer is working so independently. Sometimes cinematographer works independently. Like, everyone has a lot of power in this film, and I think it takes a willing director to, like, to just let go a little bit.
So is this your idea of your entire career? I mean, do you want to do this?
No, I do. I do want to make what I kind of feel is a trilogy, which is my the based kind of a next level of this form that I'm working on. But no, I want to make all different kinds of movies, and we're working on a script right now that's still plays with form and darkness, but it's less abstract.
So slightly more dictatorship for you.
A little bit more dictatorship, but still collaborative. But like, just not. Memphis was about abstraction. Like, mm-hmm. Memphis was about experimenting, and some of my films I'd like to be about executing, you know, about having a vision and building on that vision in more organized tones.
And did you shoot DSLR, or is that...
We shot the Canon C300 and with Zeiss lenses, with some really nice cinema lenses,
because for a film that's so, you know, open, it's quite gorgeous. It's quite beautiful to look at.
Chris Dapkins, fantastic cinematographer. And, you know, I don't buy the whole argument about film and video anymore. I think that's a 20-year-old argument. I think a DP can make beautiful images. It's all about who that DP is. It's not about the tools as much as about how you handle what the eye is saying with the tools.
So the lushness is really kind of a character in the film.
Absolutely. Texture, color, nature, all of that is real, and camera movement, all of that is really important to me. And I don't know if we'd be able to do that with film. I mean, I think we'd make a beautiful film, but I think we're making a beautiful film, whatever the medium is. You know, mm-hmm. It's how you approach it.
Well, probably not for $150,000. I mean, the funny thing is, comparing film and video, usually the price difference is not that significant. But for the kind of film you seem to want to make, it would seem that shooting on film would be prohibitive.
Well, I don't roll the camera over and over, like, on and on. I really don't. It is more of a, we just don't do a lot of takes. We because I'm open to a lot of what happens. I mean, if there's something that's not working and I don't like, we keep doing takes, or we move the angle, or we move on. You know, mm-hmm. It's not, the vibe isn't there. But, you know, typically I'm not like David Fincher getting 150 takes and stuff. We're getting one or two things, and that's enough. But I think you can make a beautiful film for much less money. And I think it has to do with what you're placing in front of the camera. And I think video suffers from lighting. And I think there's plenty of light and it captures all this great twilight. There's very little you need. So you need someone who's okay with minimalism. And usually that's more of a doc, like a doc guy. And Chris is, first and foremost, a verite cinematographer.
So did you have other people with you that could tell you how the vibe was feeling to them? I mean, or did it matter at that point? I mean,
we were on, like on a mystic boat ride in the river. We were really all together on it. There are questions and there's frustration. It's a film, but I've never really dug when, like, someone's like, "Oh, I have I have two more days of this film. It's such a slog. It's like so horrendous." I mean, if we're gonna do it and not make a lot of money in these cases, like, do it for the process. Like, create a really incredible environment so everyone can get into it and have fun. If you can get people to believe that what they're doing is important, then your film has no limits. So I do think, like, yes, this film has this vibe where it's it's going beyond different borders to me. And I think that's because our crew was really, didn't act like a crew. They act like, it felt very natural, and everybody was very, very positive and excited and gave their all. And there wasn't like 18-hour days or, you know, it was civilized.
But again, it demands your fearlessness.
Sure, man. Mine to start, and then everybody else's, you know? I mean, there's resistance. There's like, and you know, you give a production designer not a lot of time. That's like, that's not fair to him, you know? But if you give him just enough time and make him know that all he has to do, he can condense his vision, mm-hmm. or that I believe in him. And, you know, if you believe in people and they have great talent, they go for it even more. If they're constantly worried, then they're just gonna be trying to please you instead of doing their art, you know? Producing was, I'm sure, the biggest challenge of the whole thing, because you have to, you're making a documentary, but it's planned out, but it's not. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And you still have to feed people. I do, that's the scary part. And you still have to,
you still have to feed people, you have to plan people, you have to make a lot of decisions ahead of time as a producer, and I wasn't really allowing that. But what we were giving back in the dailies, which we would all watch together, is, you know, we were just knew we were onto something. It was not a big film, and not necessarily a film that makes sense to everybody, but like we were definitely felt like we were onto something.
So you guys found your erection during each night of dailies? I mean, you like saw the dailies and you were like, okay, we got.
No. We would see the dailies, and but all everybody would take a sigh of relief. Like everybody would be like, wow, what we're making is really dope. You know what I mean?
And yeah, but that's like an exciting. I mean, that's a. Firstly, these days people aren't really watching dailies very much anyway.
Yeah.
Certainly
yeah.
not as a group.
Yeah.
And no, then the idea that each day you're going to judge whether you hit the note,
right,
you know, and like,
right.
Because it is like a. It's not like a tone poem. It's like a piece of music.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
really, and you have to like judge that fragment yeah. of your song.
There's a lot of good. There was a lot of good moments. People really dug it. You know, like it wasn't a critical thing as much as we were proud of what was coming out and all just gathering together watching it, you know?
So what was Post like?
My editor, Seth Bomsey, does the sound design, the first run of sound design too, so it was very much a two-man show. John would come in and watch rough cuts, or not even rough cuts, but like scene cuts and stuff. It was a rush. Like we had to finish for the Venice Film Festival, so what we showed at the Venice Film Festival was really more of a rough cut. And then we spent two more months before Sundance editing the present cut. So it was a process. Like we had to rush. So you know when you get a lot of stuff when you walk away from something, mm-hmm. and we didn't have a lot of that time. You know, so it didn't feel like a rush, but it felt like an intense period of time. Mm-hmm. And then we do sound design with a couple different guys, like cleaning it up and. You know, that's a big part of the movie, I think, and if you watch it with surround sound, it's really fun. And so we had people giving us favors to do, to make it an overall like sensory experience.
So what kind of mistake would you have made with the version that was in Venice? I mean, is it
it's just even more loose. It's like vapor. It goes this way and goes that way, and a lot of is the same way as in there. But what we did was just like we just got it more under control. You know, there were more kids in the movie. There were just some of it was really really cool, but it was we had to streamline it. It had to like at least flow down instead of like all over the place.
So it gave the audience too much of an opportunity to take a veer off to the right.
First 20 minutes in Venice were really, really great, and then you hear the seats start going. It's a little bit of a ruthless film festival that way, but it helped us, you know, getting that reaction was like, all right, we know there's more work to do, you know.
And how do you feel you feel better about this version than you do about that version?
For sure, it's a better film, totally better film.
Is there another film in 6 months that if you went back and cut for 3 months?
There could be. I mean, there's a lot of crap on the floor too. Like, I mean, some of the stuff is out because it's out. But some of the stuff is out because probably there wasn't time and there wasn't this direction. But I mean, John and I were just talking about certain things that maybe could have made work if there was a different direction or a different time and that kind of stuff. But I'm also like that, I wouldn't make any other film.
Right.
Like the spirit of the film and the structure of the film and the strange quality of the film is all over any film that would come out of here. You know?
It sounds like you have a John Gordon Levitt, or not John Gordon Levitt, Joe Gordon Levitt, Joseph Gordon Levitt episode of his series waiting to happen, where people could recut your film, go in and get the outtakes and kind of make another version of your movie.
That's cool. I never even heard of that. Well, it's like, but didn't Steven Soderbergh did that with the Lodge Kerrigan movie? Lodge Kerrigan's movie is way better, but it was interesting to see both cuts.
Yeah.
No, there's a lot. We could make a different movie, but it would be the exact same. It would be the same movie, just with different scenes. You know what I mean?
And what is your, I mean, do you have a connection to those people? I mean, it's an interesting thing. There are no actors
no,
in the
no,
entire thing.
No, none.
So have you shown the film to the people
who are in
the movie?
We go down to Memphis on Friday.
Oh, you haven't been done it yet?
No, the Memphis premiere is on the 19th of September.
So will they all be in one room together?
Yeah, or over the weekend, that you know.
I mean, it sounds like a Fellini movie, really.
It'll be very interesting. Listen, it's definitely, we've had some tough screenings, but the Memphis screenings will be really intense.
So what happens at a tough screening?
What happens at a tough screening used to be people walked out. I don't think people really walk out now. I think some people are very concerned with that there's no plot or there's no story. And my answer is that I do think this movie has tons of story. Like, dripping with story. It's just told in a very slow and a kind of, outside way. And I think that that's still story. So the best screenings are when people come and they say, like, wow, that's something new. Like, I felt like that was something new. And the harder parts are like, so did he cut an album? Like, where's the record? And it's just like, well, I don't know what record you're talking about. You know, it's two different directions. But I do like that some people think it's a Christian movie, or some people think it's a pagan movie, or some people, like, people have different ideas about what's going on. They think the kid is his son, or they think, you know, who's the kid, what's the kid, like all that stuff. And I like that the fact that you know, people are thinking about it the next day, and not bothered by it. You know, if you're bothered by it, it lasts only for a little while. But if you're affected by it in a positive way, it lasts for a long time.
And why Memphis and not Detroit or someplace like that?
Memphis's relationship to the Delta. You know, it's the northern tip of the Mississippi Delta, and I think that is like where all American folklore comes from. You know, it's an ancient place. And so I wanted it to be based in Memphis, and to me that's like Detroit is a bummer, has had some bummer times and some great times. I do think like Memphis's relationship to like the church, and its relationship to the Mississippi River, and it's also it's like that's where Martin Luther King got shot. It's where Elvis is from. There's highs and lows going on that are kind of unmeasurable, and lots of musicians went down to Memphis to cut an album so they could offer a piece or like some kind of connection to it. And that's what I felt like doing as a filmmaker, is like there's a million stories that make up Memphis, and now there's a million and one, you know, like that kind of try to visualize my own life, my own dream life, but you know, there.
So was the Graceland section completely shot on lipstick cameras cut out, or?
Yeah. Listen, I dig Elvis, and those guys that you saw playing, they played with Elvis, you know? But there is a cookie cutter Memphis. There is a tourist Memphis, and some of it is totally worthwhile. But I put that scene on Beale Street where Willis goes really apeshit for a reason, because I think that place is devoid of what it started with. You know what I mean? It's the death of the blues now, man.
Mm-hmm. So had you spent a lot of time down there before all this?
Oh, before the shooting, we spent six weeks prepping, getting to know people, like do scouting, talking with people. But I had been to Memphis. We'd been as a team 3 times before that, at least. And then I'd been a couple times when I was younger doing projects or just driving around. And I don't have any solid connection to it other than it's like one of those mountaintops for me, you know? It's a legendary place. And
so it's just
always
a gut
felt that
thing
way.
For you?
Yeah, it was a gut thing, totally.
And everybody came along to play?
Yeah. Yeah, everyone came along to play, added their voice, and the people in Memphis, listen, there are gonna be a lot of people in Memphis who don't get this movie or don't like this movie. But every frame in this movie is about respect, and it's trying to make something beautiful and meaningful in its own way that's confusing at times, or that's challenging at times, or that is hard, but it's always filled with like, I find it an incredibly hopeful movie, and that's what, that to me, even in Willis's despair, I feel like this movie is really authentic. I think it's really authentic of the people there, of the experience you can have there, and at the same time, it's beautiful. Like, I feel like even if people don't want to see this overgrown cracks in the sidewalk, like, that's what it is, and it's beautiful, and it's okay, you know?
So is that the, I mean, is that your role in part as a director these days, to understand the context of your work and what your aspirations are versus what the market's demanding?
Or? Well, I think that's part of it. I think that same director has to figure out what the market is going to watch, or you can't make movies, if you know. In this kind of situation, I hate movies that are like biopics about musicians, where it's like, I just wanted to make something that is in the mind of someone like Thelonious Monk. Mm-hmm. Or someone like Otis Redding could watch this all stoned out of his mind and be like, that's me. You know, mm-hmm. like that's how it feels. And so that's what guided it, being a filmmaker and making an art film. I had a specific funder who allowed that to happen, mm-hmm. And a specific group of people who wanted to do that. I do think, like, you know, Memphis is getting way more distribution than it could have. It's getting a lot of press. It didn't have to. And it's a very, very, like, it's a strange form. But people mm-hmm. are talking about it. You know, the people who watch it don't just dismiss it.
Right.
Even the negative criticism is taking it seriously. So I do think you have to be aware of what you're trying to do as a filmmaker. I wish movies like this made money? Yeah, but it's like, that's asking a lot.
So the strange form, I mean, do you instinctually, I mean, is the form that you know you were doing and that somehow becomes the thing that you were, I mean, it feels so kind of by touch for mm-hmm. you. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, it does feel like your ambition is to create a form
sure.
at some level.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So is it fulfilling that ambition, or are you getting better at it? In the third movie, you'll be even better at it?
Well, I think that's a really good point, and I think about that a lot. And I think about the three, if you were tagging these three movies together, the first movie was about discovery. It was about discovering a form. It was about youth, so it's about youth discovering the world. The second movie was purely about experimentation. Willis as an experimental character in the world, and the film shows that. And I feel like the next film should be about execution. It should take this form that's very experimental and make it absolutely accessible to a larger audience. So I'm basing that would be based around a social issue. So it has a nucleus, the way that Willis was a nucleus, but Willis is a psychedelic nucleus. This is more of a center point that everyone can understand. And then the other, so I do think, like, I'm getting better in terms of, like, I'm going through different stages. And I think that's what's important, to move forward as a director, develop your voice, but be open to the story, like the topic. Like the other film I'm developing, we scripted it. We're looking to make something a little bit more, not traditional, but in the classic cinema sense, like making something with a familiar structure.
So if Sean Penn comes to you and says, hey man, I love your work, I want to be in your next film, is that going to ruin it? Would that be?
I'll take that all the way. You know what I mean? But I think that's one of the next stages, David. I think that's one of the next stages. You take this form where people are like, is it real, is it not? And and you put someone who's absolutely, absolutely a celebrity in it, but you take them out of it. Like, you take mm-hmm. that celebrity out of it and you make a great performance. I think this form would lend itself to, like, endless possibilities with that. It's like the Dardenne and Marion Cotillard. Like, my God, mm-hmm. biggest movie, hottest movie star in the fucking world, and yet, She does a great job, and they do a great job with her. They can keep going doing what they're doing, but that's right. a new step for them. And I definitely feel working with talented actors, first of all, would be would make it explode.
The funny thing is that the Dardans, you know, insist that they are commercial filmmakers and not art house filmmakers.
Yeah, I don't buy any of that.
That they're looking to the masses, and so Marion is a kind of obvious choice for them as opposed to a.
Well, I think it's smart. I mean, I'm learning that it's very obvious to, like, get a face in there no matter what. But I think if she obviously was, they could have a lot of people, you know, wanting to be in their movies because what they do is so specialized.
Yeah.
And so it's always going to play at Cannes, and it's always going to be respected unless they totally tank. And I do think, like, if actors see Willis in my movie, like, Willis gets free reign, like he goes mm-hmm. all the way, and I think it's attractive to an actor who has to be put in a box all the time. So
you're wide open to
Wide open, absolutely. Absolutely. That's why I'm here. You know?
That's part of the form.
Yeah. Yo, exactly. exactly.
I'm getting it.
Yeah.